Now look at there, finally over halfway through this number, and we finally get a different camera angle, right? That's all one take from start to finish there, which is quite a remarkable feat in film at least. On stage, the musical theater people are saying, yeah, we get one take start to finish, curtain up to curtain down. That's one frickin' take. Hello everyone, Mark Daniel Patrick here, musical theater coach. Thank you so much for taking time to check out the channel. I do want to take this opportunity to let you know, starting next week, we will be posting new videos on Thursdays and Fridays at 4 p.m. Pacific Time, 7 p.m. Eastern. But you can always subscribe, turn on notifications so you never miss an upcoming episode anyway. Don't forget, you can find me on Instagram at Mark Daniel Patrick or at my website at markdanielpatrick.com. Normally on this channel, we hesitate to dip into the movie musical realm, and that's entirely because films generally opt for pre-recorded vocals. And that's one of the most impressive things about the musical is an actor's ability to act, dance, and sing live. Love it or hate it, director Tom Hooper turned that notion on its head in 2012 with his release of Les Misérables, opting for all 50 numbers of the film to be sung 100% live. Of course, many critics, even ones who have commented on our very channel, have expressed concerns over a lot of the film's casting choices. But I'd say the clip we're going to watch today, the casting director got this one 100% spot on. From Les Misérables, this is Eddie Redmayne performing Empty Chairs at Empty Tables.
There's a grief that can't be spoken. There's a pain that goes on and on. Empty chairs at empty tables. Now my friends are dead and gone.
I cannot stress enough how much I love the opening of this number. I mean, they would never be brave enough to do it in a stage version of this show, of course. And that's because the musical is so much known for the music and for the orchestra, right? That's a good 50% of what you're going to see musical theater for, is about the music and that swelling orchestra that really pulls you into each and every number. So they'd never be able to get away with it, of course, in the stage version, but I would love to see them try. How hard-hitting is that to allow your actor to start the first 30 seconds of this number 100% a cappella? I absolutely love it. It's such a great choice. It's easy for a film to do, of course, like we said, but I just love how emotional and how much it makes you lean forward and really pay attention to everything he's saying.
Here it was, they lit the flame. Here they sang about tomorrow. And tomorrow never came.
I love that low note on Came. He sits in it, he spends time there, he gets deep into it, and really rounds out the note. I hear a lot of actors sing this song and they're afraid to sit in those low notes and afraid to really round them out and bring them forward. Emotionally, I love what Eddie's doing here. He's really, you could tell he's just sitting here in the tragedy of this moment and really just putting his thoughts into words. He's on his own, letting himself really feel everything about what's just taken place, and really letting himself sit in the tragedy of that moment. And with that, you can tell how Tom Hooper's going to shoot this number and how he shot this entire film. He's really going to rely on his actors to tell the story, right? A lot of filmmakers will allow 50% of the job to be done by their cinematographer, where you can create a lot of emotion, a lot of feeling by sweeping shots, by landscape shots, or by a lot of different things you're going to do with camera angles. Here, everything is very tight. Everything comes in on the actor, and he's just going to let his actors tell the story. Love it or hate it, like we said off the top, that's the way he's decided to shoot this. And for the most part, I would say, especially for this number, it does work out.
And they rose with voices ringing, and I can hear them now. The very words that they have sung became their last communion.
The falsetto he's using on these notes is quite good. He puts a lot of heavy vibrato on them to make sure they don't go anywhere off key, which is a great vocal technique that's absolutely fine. And he's able to sing while he's crying. Now, I don't know if they assisted him by putting some drops in his eyes, but nevertheless, he's not getting stuffed up. There's not a lot of strain on his voice because of that emotion he's bringing to the song. That's why a lot of singers on stage will stay away from actually physically crying on stage, is because you do get very stuffed up and it prohibits you from resonating here, which is really going to cut off a lot of the quality of the sound. But he's able to do it, which is... It's incredible, so I'm not sure if they assisted him at all, but he's able to get it out quite well, and it sounds just fine to me, and it looks quite emotional when he's able to do both at the same time.
On this lonely barricade, a door. Oh, my friends, forgive me. That I live and you are gone.
Oh, I just love the version of this song. I love the way he's approached it right from the start, right up until now. It's a beautiful song with a beautiful melody, but he's really focusing on telling the story rather than getting into those melodic, beautiful phrases and just singing what's written for kind of no reason. He's really making sure he hits home every point of the song and every single word that comes up here. And it's so heart-wrenching watching him sing each and every line of this piece.
There's a grief that can't be spoken. There's a pain goes on and on. Phantom faces at the windows. Phantom shadows on the floor.
Now look at there, finally, over halfway through this number, and we finally get a different camera angle, right? That's all one take from start to finish there, which is quite a remarkable feat in film, at least. On stage, the musical theater people are saying, yeah, we get one take start to finish, you know, curtain up to curtain down. That's one frickin' take. But anyway, so halfway through this number, we finally get a different camera angle, but we still don't get that long shot. We still don't get that sense of where he is. Of course, if you watch the film prior to him starting to sing this song, we do get a sense of where he is. But in the actual piece, they don't give him anything. They don't give him that long shot to see empty chairs at empty tables. Sorry for the obvious, but they don't give him that emotional setting of this is where, you know, this is what he's looking at, this is what he's experiencing. It's really focused on everything that he's going to emote and bring to the scene. And so I get it. I do love this approach. I would maybe 10%. I would love 10%. Just give us a little bit of context of where he is, what he's looking at. But overall, of course, knowing me, I do love the way this number is shot.
Empty chairs at empty tables, where my friends will meet no more. Oh, my friends, my friends, don't ask me what your sacrifice was for.
Oh. So good. It's incredible. He comes at it again from a very actor first perspective. And that's that I've always said, I will love that to the day I die. I love that actor first mentality when you're performing. As he starts to move through the climax of this song, you can hear a little bit of that strain in the voice where he's just not professionally trained. So he doesn't have that full open quality that a Michael Ball or a Jonathan Antoine is gonna sort of give you. But he hits that high G pretty well, honestly. It's from an emotional place, and he's really, you know, struggling with the loss of all of his comrades, obviously, and that's really what he's trying to play up rather than swelling into that big climactic moment vocals first. So he's really stressing the emotion of this song, and it just comes down to a preference whether you love that approach or not.
Empty chairs at empty tables, where my friend will sing no more.
again, I would take this 100 times over. I love people who are going to actually perform a song rather than just sing it beautifully through. That's really what I'm looking for, is perform the song. Give me what's written. Tell me the subtext. Don't just sing those beautiful melodic lines for no reason. I love that approach constantly. I will say it over and over again on this channel. I can't say it enough. Give us the context. Give us that story. Dig deep. Show us what you're feeling and then sing, right? There's so many moments in every single song for you to dig deep and really bring out the context of the song. And there are also moments in every song that hit a climax that allow you to open up vocally and show off those vocal pipes. That's fine. Do it when you can. Songs like this, give us the story. Tell the story first. Sing about it later. You know, we talked about casting choices at the beginning. This is one that I think they got right. I think Eddie pulls his weight enough in the vocal department to really, you don't stop and think, that's a harsh note. You don't stop and think, oh, he kind of can't really get through this vocally. He manages to get through every song he sings quite well. Again, it's not going to give you that Michael Ball beautiful tone that you're so used to hearing, but it does give you an emotional side of the story that maybe hits home a little bit harder for you, that maybe makes it sit a little bit deeper, where the tragedy of this, of that, you know, there's so many stories about how, you know, in war or in battles, there's that remorse of the one who survived and all of his comrades died. In this moment, in this song, you can almost see he rather would have died. He rather would have perished with his friends, because then he doesn't have to sit and just experience this and feel this gut wrench of an emotion. But I feel like from start to finish, this song and this show, really, this film rather, from start to finish, I think Eddie Redmayne hits the right note and does an absolutely fantastic job. Okay, that's all the time we have for this video. I promise you there will be more Les Mis clips coming up in the future, so don't worry about that. In the meantime, send me a comment below, let me know what you think of this video, and what you'd like to see in the future. Until next time, I'm Mark Daniel Patrick, and thanks so much for watching.